back students, in this short video I am going to demonstrate you the norma occipitalis, that means the skull as seen from backside or from posterior aspect. Okay, whatsoever you are seeing, I am holding the skull as you are seeing it from the posterior aspect. Now let us see in this posterior aspect what are the bones which will form the norma occipitalis or the posterior aspect of the skull. Now there are the right and left parietal bones. See this? This is the posterior part or posterior end of the right. This is the left and this is the right parietal bone is there. And they are separated from each other with the help of this midline suture, what is called as the sagittal suture. Now in this sagittal suture, the posterior most part of the sagittal suture, at the junction of it with the two lambdoid suture, there is a presence of a piece of the bone, what is called as a sutural bone, because it is present within the sagittal suture just above the point lambda. Okay, so this is a sagittal suture. Otherwise, normally this posterior end of the suture of sagittal suture should meet with the anterior ends of the right and the left lambdoid suture. So this are the right and left lambdoid suture. Now then, the second bone which is present here is the squamous part of the occipital bone. Squamous part means that flat part of the, because when you will go, I mean to say, when you will learn the individual bone of forming the skull, the occipital bone is quite a big bone, large bone, which has the posterior part as the squamous or the flat bone. Okay, so this is the squamous part of the occipital bone. Thus there are three bones which forms right and left parietal bone and the squamous part of the occipital bone. But at the same time, to this norma occipitalis, in the posterolateral corners of this norma occipitalis, you will see the presence of this projection or the process of the bone, which is the process of the temporal bone. This is the temporal bone, and this projection or process which looks like the nipple is called as the mammillary process. Okay, so the mammillary process like structure, okay, nipple like structure, and here it is called as the mastoid part of the right and left temporal bone. Okay, right and left temporal bone. So this projection, okay, the bony projection, which is the mastoid process here, they will be present in the right and left corner of this norma occipitalis. So two parietal, occipital, and then the third bone here is the mastoid process of the temporal bone, mastoid. Let us come to the sutures which are present in between these three types of bone, that is mastoid, occipital, and parietal. Now there is a posterior part of the sagittal suture which I have already described, which lies between the two parietal bones separating the right and left parietal bone. So this is the, and there is a presence of a sutural bone is seen here. Then there are right and the left lambdoid sutures are there, okay, and this right and the left lambdoid sutures, they are separating the posterior border of the parietal bone with that of the this squamous part of the occipital bone. Okay, they are squamous part of the occipital bone is separated by the parietal bone with the help of the lambdoid suture. Then there are the right and left parietomastoid suture, and for this I will just little tilt it here. And you will see here that this suture, which is on the uppermost part of the mastoid process, this suture, if you can see it, yes, this suture, and this with that of the parietal bone, this suture is called as parietomastoid suture. It is, so this is another on the right side as well as on the left side, this is the parietomastoid suture. Then there will be right and left occipitomastoid suture, this suture. This is the suture which is called as occipitomastoid, that is between the occipital bone and the mastoid bone. See here, this is of the right side. Occipitomastoid, between the occipital bone and the mastoid. So this is the right occipitomastoid suture, okay? Right occipitomastoid suture is there. Now, the parietal, occipital and mastoid. So this, the parietal, occipital and mastoid, these three are meeting, bones are meeting here, okay? How they are meeting? They are meeting at the junction of the lambdoid suture, lower end, then parietomastoid suture, and then occipitomastoid suture. The three sutures are meeting at this point. And this point is called as asterion, enclosing an area which completely encloses the ends of these three sutures, okay? That area is called as the asterion. So this point is called as asterion on right and left side. Okay, if you see here at the asterion, there is another small sutural bone is seen here. See, this is small ossical bone. There are small ossicles are also seen in the right lambdoid suture. There is one or two here also present onto the left lambdoid suture, okay? So these are the sutures, that is sagittal and lambdoid. They usually show the presence of the bony ossicles, which are called as sutural bones because they are present within the sutures, and they are separate isolated bone because they ossify from a separate centers. Let us, after learning the bones forming the norma occipitalis or posterior region of the skull and the sutures which are involved in this area, we come to the bony features. Okay, in the bony feature, most important point is this. See this here in the squamous part of the occipital bone, almost in the median plane here, this bony projection is called as the external occipital protuberance. External occipital protuberance, okay? And this is the highest point of the occipital bone, and this sometime is also known as inion, I-N-I-O-N. So this point is also called as the inion. Extending laterally from this external occipital protuberance, that is, there is a curved line, okay? That curved line is going from this external occipital protuberance towards the mastoid process, okay? And another line is present above this line, and this line was called as superior nuchal line. So from external occipital protuberance, one of the line is going, which is towards the mastoid process, and this is called as the superior nuchal line. And just above the superior nuchal line, there is another line, fent line is present here, and that line is called as the highest nuchal line, again going towards the mastoid process. With the pencil, I will just draw, this is the superior nuchal line, and this one is the highest nuchal line. Highest nuchal line, and this is the superior nuchal line, and this point is the external occipital protuberance, okay? External. So these are the lines, superior and the highest nuchal line, okay? Highest nuchal line. Then there will be a crest, and this crest is starting from the tip of the external occipital protuberance or inion and going in the midline right up to the posterior margin of this foramina. Okay, now I'm just tilting, though it is not the part of the norma occipitalis, but just to complete this line, that is the external occipital crest, which is a midline, okay, which is extending from external occipital protuberance right up to that of the posterior margin of the foramina magnum. Okay, then there is another line present here, okay, which is coming out almost from the middle of the external occipital crest and going laterally towards the mastoid process. And this line, which you can see here, is a quite prominent line here. It is called as the inferior nuchal line. So this is the highest nuchal line on either side. This is the superior nuchal line and this is the inferior nuchal line. They are present both on right and that of the left side. Okay, they are present on right and the left side. So these are the bony features which are seen here. Sometime a foramina is seen that is called as the mastoid foramina here, okay, which gives passage to an emissary vein. And a minute branch of the occipital artery may pass through this emissary, mastoid foramina, okay? From that of the mastoid foramina, from the posterior aspect of the mastoid process. This completes the bony features of the norma occipitalis. I will just draw this diagram of this norma occipitalis and then we'll tell you about the particular features. This is the posterior aspect outline of the norma occipitalis and I will draw here the posterior most, part of the sagittal suture. So this is the sagittal suture. Then extending from sagittal suture will be the lambdoid suture. So these are the right and left lambdoid suture. And then this will be the parietomastoid suture. Okay, this will be called as the parietomastoid suture. That being the parietal bone and the mastoid process. This is the mastoid process. Mastoid in the lateral angle. Mastoid process. This is also the mastoid process. So this will be the parietomastoid suture. This is also on the right side. Parietomastoid suture. And then a suture will be going downward that is called as the occipitomastoid suture. And that area which enclose this ends of these three sutures is called as the asterion. Okay, that area enclosing these three sutures, junctional point of the three suture is called as asterion. This is the external occipital protuberance. And from external occipital protuberance, a arch line going towards the mastoid process is the highest nuchal line. And this is the external occipital crest going right up to the foramina magnum. Let me write it here. External occipital crest. C-R-E-S-T. Crest. E-A-S-T. External occipital crest is here. Okay. And then there is from external occipital protuberance and another line going here is the superior nuchal line. This was the highest. Nuchal line and this is the superior nuchal line. The superior nuchal line is considered to be the junction between the head and the neck. That means below the superior nuchal line, whatsoever material, whatsoever soft tissues and skin is there, it is the part of the neck and above that it is the part of the head. Now from almost the middle of the external occipital crest, and another line is going towards the mastoid process and that is called as the inferior nuchal line. Let me write it here. This is the inferior nuchal line, right? Okay, and this was the lambda, our lambda, and in this specimen, okay, you are seeing a sutural bone here at the posterior end of the sagittal suture. So I just will draw this sutural bone. This is the sutural bone is here. Let us quickly see what are the soft tissue attached to that of the norma occipitalis. Okay, soft tissue attached to the norma occipitalis. Now to the highest nuchal line. Okay, there is the attachment of an aponeurosis on both the side, right and left, up to the this, I mean to say, extending on either side of the this external occipital protuberance, and this is the highest nuchal line, and this is the epicranial aponeurosis, okay, the part of the skull, okay, it is a membrane, aponeurotic membrane, fibrous tissue layer. And on either side of that, there is the presence of a or origin of a muscle, which is thin muscle, and this muscle is called as occipitalis. Please write down the name, okay, as I am drawing you, please, as I have no space to write here. This on the highest nuchal line laterally is the occipitalis, and here medially on either side is that of the epicranial aponeurosis. Then coming to the superior nuchal line, medially from the external occipital protuberance to the superior nuchal line, most medially, there is the origin of a muscle called as trapezius, right and left trapezius. And then from external occipital protuberance right up to the foramina magnum, there is attachment of a ligament, what is called as ligamentum nuchae, which separates the muscle on the right side and left side of the this norma occipitalis. Now then, to the lateral side of the this superior nuchal line extending on to the mastoid process, there is the long attachment of the muscle called as the sternocleidomastoid. Okay. Right. So this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle serratus. If you are having the color pencil, it will be better. You just keep on drawing it with the color. I just forgot to bring the color pencil for this sitting. Okay, so this is trapezius and then sternocleidomastoid. They are present, I mean say, getting attachment onto the superior nuchal line. Sternocleidomastoid is insertion and trapezius is the origin. Okay, then let us see an area between superior nuchal line and the inferior nuchal line. And this area gives origin to the two strong muscles of the neck. Medial one is called a semispinalis capitis. I will just write semispinalis capitis, SSC, semispinalis capitis, the origin. Okay, and then there is an oblique capitis superior. Then lateral to it is another muscle. Okay, I will just write oblique capitis superior. Oblique capitis superior. So this is oblique capitis superior and this is the semispinalis capitis. These are the two muscles which are attached between the superior and inferior nuchal line. Out of these two, semispinalis capitis is placed medially towards the external occipital crest and oblique capitis superior is laterally towards the mastoid process. Then similarly, there are two muscles attached between the inferior nuchal line and foramina magnum margin, okay, which may not be seen properly in this view, that is in the norma occipitali, because this is the inferior nuchal line. And if you will turn this, then only you can reach right up to the foramina magna, which may become the part of the norma basalis externa. Okay, which we will learn again when we will go to the external aspect of the base of the skull. But here I will just mention two muscles which may not be the part of the this norma occipitalis. The medial one is rectus capitis superior. They are present on both the sides, same, okay, right hand. So I am using it here onto the opposite side, and this is the rectus capitis superior, and then lateral to it will be the rectus capitis inferior. I mean to say, rectus capitis posterior major, not superior, rectus capitis, let me write, rectus capitis posterior major and rectus capitis posterior minor. So these are the two muscles. Rectus capitis posterior major is medial and rectus capitis posterior minor is lateral. Thus four strong muscles, they are attached between superior nuchal line and the posterior margin of foramina magnum on either side of the median crest, that is the external occipital crest. Okay, so this completes the structures, I mean to say soft tissue attachment onto the this norma occipitalis. And as I said that epicranial aponeurosis will run anteriorly and it will cover this part of the bone, okay, because it is the part of the scalp, and this muscle, that is the muscle occipitalis, will go and get attachment to this norma, I mean to say this aponeurosis, epicranial aponeurosis, which become the part of the scalp. So the scalp is limited posteriorly up to the highest nuchal line. Okay, up to the highest nuchal line. Okay, thank you very much for watching this short video on the norma occipitalis.